Good evening, everybody, and welcome all of you to the live program number 155 at Orthopedic Principles. We are back with our exceptional faculty, Dr. Ichabodi from Medicare Hospitals, Hyderabad. If you have noticed, Dr. Krishnakiran has lectured earlier with us on four different occasions. Dr. Kiran is also an alumni from the All India Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi. He has several publications and book chapters, and some of his publications are quoted and cited multiple times in high impact journals. And today, Dr. Krishna is going to enlighten us on dislocation after total hip replacement. Over to you, Krishna.
Thank you, Hitesh. Good evening, everyone. Today, we will talk about dislocation after total hip arthroplasty. Now, if you look at the literature, the incidence of dislocation has been variable, but by and large, it's been reported between 2 and 3% for primary total hip arthroplasty. Advances in surgical technique like augmentation of the posterior capsular repair has now brought about a reduction in the dislocation to less than 1% in most of the series of total hip arthroplasties. It is important to note that more than half the dislocations occur within the first 3 months and more than three-fourths occur within the first year. So it's an early complication and it's a catastrophic complication both for the patient as well as for the surgeon. And there are several factors which can be responsible for dislocated total hip arthroplasty. 2 to 11% of primary and 4 to 25% of revision THR are associated with recurrent dislocation. Most common cause for failure of revision hip is again dislocation, and it's important to note that if there is instability once which leads to a revision, then that is more likely to be there later on at the time of re-revision. So instability is likely to recur in the patients. One third of the patients require re-operation. So it's important to note this. Not all patients with hip dislocation after surgery require a revision surgery unless there is gross component malposition, which you can identify, or a failure to restore the vertical or horizontal offset of the hip. So the first treatment is a close reduction. An identification of high risk group is exceptionally important. So what are the high risk patients? You can have neuromuscular and cognitive disorders as high risks for dislocation. Patients with cerebral palsy, muscular dystrophy, neurologic disorders, psychiatric problems, alcoholism. So all these patients are uncommonly candidates for total hip arthroplasty, but these are candidates where there is a higher risk of instability, which must be kept in mind, and something more must be done to start with in these patients. And one must not wait for an instability to happen to sort it out. 22% of patients with single dislocation are likely to have recurrent dislocations. 75% of those with recurrent dislocation are likely to have a subsequent dislocation. It's more frequent in women, obese patients, those with fracture neck femur and muscle weakness or imbalance and inability to comply with activity restrictions. More recently, the role of spinopelvic alignment has been talked about. We are not going into details of that. That is a talk in itself, but it will suffice here to know that patients who undergo some sort of lumbar spinal fusion, either because of spontaneous osseous ankylosis as in ankylosing spondylitis, or who undergo a lumbar fusion for their lumbosacral problems, are likely to have abnormalities of pelvic tilt and compensatory mechanisms at the spinopelvic area. And these will predispose the patients to higher risk of instability. Some examples, a post-paralytic limb with a fracture neck femur in an ambulator where you are planning to do a total hip arthroplasty. These are high risk patients with less muscle power, with instability as a complication looming large. So these must be addressed to start with the use of devices like a modular dual mobility socket, which consists of a dual articulation with a metal liner inside the acetabular socket, a small metallic head which articulates with a large polyethylene socket. So you have a tripolar sort of articulation or a dual mobility articulation, and this decreases the risk of instability. Also, the abductor insufficiency in these cases must be addressed by transferring a part of the anterior half of the gluteus maximus as described by Leo Whiteside at the outset in order to decrease the risk of instability in these patients. Patient with neuromuscular dysplasia, again, dual mobility socket to use to start with. Somebody with a recurrent dislocation, managed again with a dual mobility socket. And this is important. So now the standard of care in these high-risk categories is to use primarily a dual mobility socket. Don't wait for a repeat episode of instability to happen. And this is important point to take home. That's why I put in so many cases. Somebody who is undergoing a complex revision procedure, again, it is important to use a dual mobility socket. So we use a cage with a dual mobility cemented cup in these cases most of the times. And if you are resecting the proximal femur because of a osteosarcoma or some sort of a tumor in the proximal femur, again, you use a dual mobility socket. So these are all the high-risk situations which must be identified beforehand and managed with the use of a dual mobility socket. And the risk of instability significantly comes down once we use the dual mobility socket. Now, the surgical risk factors, the technique will influence the occurrence of dislocation. It has been shown in several studies that the posterior surgical approach has got a higher risk of instability as compared to the anterior approaches. Inadequate restoration of the soft tissue tension, component malposition, presence of impingement, head size, liner profile, and surgeon experience are all the surgical risk factors which can contribute to the occurrence of instability. If more than one factor is present, then it can be a multifactorial dislocation. The surgical approach is a controversial issue, but it is a fact that 75% to 90% of dislocations are in the posterior direction. The augmented posterior repair with drill holes in the greater trochanter and reattachment of the capsule and short external rotators has reduced the dislocation rates from the posterior approach on par with other approaches, but this still seems to be a concern. The soft tissue tension, as determined by the capsule short external rotators, the restoration of vertical and horizontal offset, what is the status of abductor and greater trochanter, and what is the size of the femoral head to the cup ratio. So these are all the things which will determine the soft tissue tension around the hip joint. And we all recognize this as an important contributor to instability. A word about component position. One must look at combined antiversion, that is the antiversion with both acetabular and femoral components in. So we are now looking more and more at combined parameters like combined length, combined offset, and combined antiversion. So we cannot use a single implant to restore the hip to a pre-arthritic level, but you will restore the overall acetabular offset, femoral offset, combined offset to the best possible situation for that patient, the combined version to the best possible situation for that patient using the available implant. You must look at the cup malposition, femoral malposition, and restoration of offset, as I talked about. Now, we all know that increasing the head size increases the head-neck ratio. This increases the jump distance with large diameter heads, and the dislocation rate is inversely proportional to the head size. So if you keep increasing the head size, the distance that the head has to travel before it comes out increases, and the impingement between the neck and the component or the soft tissue and bone and soft tissues will reduce using a larger diameter head. But there is no further benefit noted beyond 36 millimeters of head size. So what is impingement? There is a 51% reported incidence of impingement in the literature. There are three types of impingement: implant to implant impingement, that is the neck impinging on the liner or the rim of the acetabular socket; implant impinging on the bone, so if you have an anterior acetabular osteophyte which is impinging on the femoral neck; and bone impinging on bone, where you don't restore the offset properly, therefore the bone impinges on bone. So if it impinges in flexion, the hip dislocates posteriorly. If it impinges in extension, the hip dislocates anteriorly. So this is an important concept which we must check intraoperatively, must avoid impingement at all costs. You can avoid impingement by checking intraoperatively to see which direction the hip is unstable and whether there is some osteophyte which is impinging, and carefully removing the osteophytes and restoring the hip length and offset will avoid this complication of impingement. So this is how an impingement works. There is a lever action of impingement. So whenever something impinges on one another, it will act to lever out the femoral head out from the acetabulum, which happens more if the acetabular size is smaller, if the offset has not been restored properly, if we have left anterior osteophytes or posterior osteophytes in the on the acetabular or femoral sides, which lead to one or other sort of impingement. Now again, liner profile. People are tending to use more and more neutral liners, but it has been shown in the literature that an elevated lip liner is associated with a lower risk of instability. It has been shown now. So in high risk patients, it is always a good idea to use a lip liner. So that is what the literature tells us. Now, despite our best efforts, if the dislocation has happened, so that is what is the brief of this particular talk. So what should be the post-dislocation assessment? So we must see whether this is a first episode or a recurrent dislocation. What is the duration from the index operation, whether it's an early dislocation or a late dislocation because of polyethylene wear? What was the approach used, whether it's a posterior approach, whether the augmented repair was done or not? What were the implants used? What was the head diameter? What is the head neck ratio? What is the cup inclination and version? What is the direction of dislocation? And we must also always rule out a distensive dislocation because of a hematoma or infection, which is lurking large after any surgical intervention. Now, there is some differences between the early versus late dislocation. The late dislocators are more often because of polyethylene wear, and the wear leads to loosening of the implants and a change in the component alignment, and also the loss of the contained ring or something like that because of the polyethylene wear leads to instability. But in early dislocation, usually there is either soft tissue laxity, component malposition, a non-compliant patient, or infection. So these are all the factors which are present in an early dislocator. And the important point is there is a 40% recurrence rate if the dislocation is less than 5 weeks from primary surgery. And it is important to note that one or other of these factors can coexist in a given situation. So this is the classification of unstable hip. The type 1 is a malpositioned acetabular component. Type 2 is a malpositioned femoral component. And you can have a combination of acetabular and femoral malposition, as we will see as we go on. Type 3 is abductor or soft tissue insufficiency. Type 4 is impingement, either bony, soft tissue, prosthetic, or combined. Type 5 is late eccentric polyethylene wear. And type 6 is diagnosis of exclusion. So these are all important for us to understand, to classify the dislocated hip preoperatively in order to make an appropriate plan for managing these patients. Now, if you look at this X-ray, the direction of dislocation in this particular patient is anterior, and this is a multiple dislocator in a complex primary type of situation where there have been multiple episodes at close reduction and the hip continues to dislocate. And if you look at the X-ray, you can note on the X-ray that the cup looks more open, and this indicates that the antiversion is more. You can do a CT scan to measure the antiversion of the cup, but this obviously requires a cup revision. So that is what was done. The solution is to close down the cup and decrease the version, and then you have a stable outcome at the end of surgery. So we also changed the head from a 28 millimeter head to a 32 millimeter head. But now the standard of care in these situations is to use a dual mobility socket wherever it is indicated. In this particular case, we were able to get away with a 32 millimeter head. But now if you have a dislocated hip like this, we would correct the component position and add a dual mobility socket to the given situation in order to avoid this problem of recurrent instability. Another example where the cage was vertically placed and therefore the hip went on recurrently subluxating and now frankly dislocating posterior superiorly, as you can see. And this is addressed by a complete revision of the acetabulum. The cage was removed, a trabecular metal buttress augment was used, and you can see that the cup is now inclined in a more acceptable position around 40-45 degrees, and then a liner was cemented into this T-MARS construct with a 36 millimeter head. So we've made so many changes to the situation. The vertical cage was revised to a more acceptable component position. The bone loss was augmented using the buttress augment. The head size was changed from 28 to 36, and all these contributed to the increasing stability. And you can see that the abductor mechanism, which was tending to float out, was also refixed. Now, another example where you have a combined situation where you can see that the cup is obviously more vertical and excessively antiverted. There was an immediate post-operative dislocation, which was close reduced but redislocated. And if you can see, look at the relationship between the tip of the trochanter and the center of the femoral head. The center is way below the tip of the trochanter. So there is an issue with respect to the restoration of femoral offset and the length of the limb as well. And this were addressed by changing the cup positioning into more acceptable position, more closed and more physiologic version. And the stem was again revised to a more acceptable situation where the tip of the trochanter is below the level of the center of the femoral head. Ideally, you must have the opposite side X-ray to see if you're able to get the restoration of the offset and length of the limb. Now coming to a type C dislocation or type 3 dislocation because of abductor insufficiency. This was a 65-year-old male patient. A total hip replacement for an intertrochanteric fracture was done. The hip dislocated immediate post-op and has been like that for the past 3 years. And you can see that the trochanter has not been refixed, and that probably is a cause for revision. Again, in ideal scenario, these sort of cases would again be treated with a dual mobility socket in the modern day. We did this case a long time back. So we used a 36 millimeter head, reattached the trochanter and a large diameter head revision to acetabulum with better version and trochanteric fixation were the strategies employed to manage this particular situation. Now you have this femoral offset problem. You can see that this fellow is a 70-year-old man with multiple recurrent dislocations. THR was done through Harding 4 months earlier and revised once with stem revision. And you can obviously see, if you compare with the opposite side, that the offset and leg length have not been restored. But in a re-revision situation, you must always rule out infection, which was there in this particular patient. And a two-stage revision was done in this patient, a revision to a dual mobility cup, which is again a standard of care, long uncemented stem, restoration of vertical and horizontal offset, and correct inclination and version of the component. So these are the cornerstones or principles of any revision for instability. An example, a case which I did 12, 13 years back, and this dislocated because of polyethylene wear. This was a young patient with rheumatoid arthritis, and this was a relatively straightforward revision where just the modular components were exchanged. So if your components are in good position, hip has lasted long, and if polyethylene wear is the cause for instability, then you can just go in and revise the modular components. A rare form of instability, case of dysplasia, which was managed, as you can see, with a 6 Corail, and both sides there was a calcar fracture, which is again a new variety of dislocation, which we have reported subsequently in the literature, where using a tapered wedge stem, if you oversize the stem, there is a possibility of a occult femoral fracture, which becomes apparent with weight bearing. And in a patient with pre-existing osteoporosis or osteomalacia, this is a definite possibility while using uncemented components. And this can lead to a loosening sinkage of the stem and instability. So this was revised to a long stem after addressing the fracture situation. A word about the indications for constrained liners in total hip arthroplasty. The traditional indications are intraoperative multidirectional instability, multiple failed revisions due to instability, hip abductor deficiency, cognitive or neuromuscular dysfunction, no identifiable cause for instability, and a low demand patient with well-fixed components. So these are the traditional indications for constrained liners. An example where we don't use a classical constrained liner anymore, but this is a case with infected hip arthroplasty where the proximal femur was removed, And we used a snap fit cup from Link, which is again a sort of a constrained cup, but it has got not the full constraint, but the head gets locked into the cup. So it's a good cheap alternative to use in such situations. And this is how a constrained liner looks like. So you have a ring, metallic ring. So the head gets locked in to the, you just bang the head into the polyethylene liner, which contains the ring, and then the ring is used to lock it. So this is a classical constrained liner. So it doesn't allow the head to come out. But if you just use it along with an uncemented socket, the uncemented socket can pull out. So the principle is to use this whenever the components are well fixed, well aligned, and any correctable cause of dislocation has been addressed. And if you are using it primarily in a situation where you want to put an uncemented socket, then multiple screw fixation must be used for the uncemented socket. Otherwise, this cup will pull out. So whenever constrained liners are being implanted, we must pay attention to proper cup positioning, use of multiple screws to fix the cup. We must have a good trial detection to look for areas of impingement. So the use of a constrained cup does not give you license to malposition the socket. We must restore the impingement-free range of motion and must pay attention to stem version and offset restoration. Now, when we look at the long-term outcome of consecutive constrained assembler components, literature has shown a 42.1% long-term failure rate. So the use of constrained liners has largely been supplanted by the use of dual mobility sockets, as I've shown you in multiple series, multiple case examples in my own experience. So the constrained versus dual mobility, several papers are out. With repeat revision for instability as an endpoint, the failure rate was 23% for the constrained group and 5.5% for the dual mobility cup. So the even in complex situations, the dual mobility scores over the constrained liner. So in our book, an elderly patient with a well-fixed component is probably the only indication where you would avoid removing the whole thing and just putting a cemented constrained liner in that particular situation. So as I told you, the constrained liner itself is not a solution to any problem. I'll just show you the X-ray. I'm sorry about that. So the this particular case had a abductor deficiency and was managed with a constrained liner. And you can see that a constrained liner failed because constrained liner was not the solution for this particular problem. This particular problem required abductor reattachment. So the critical point is to identify whether there is acetabular malposition, femoral malposition, combined malposition, whether the abductor mechanism is lax, whether there is impingement, whether it's a late dislocation, or whether it's a multidirectional instability. So these are all the factors which you must look at when we are assessing the patient with instability. And each and every factor must be identified and addressed when we are doing a revision surgery. Now, the dual mobility is not the holy grail for all situations. It can still dislocate. So this was a case done by me, 64-year-old schizophrenic patient, underwent THR for fracture neck femur. She had a fall and dislocated the hip. The key So as I told you, this patient had a repeated episodes of instability, and the problem was abductor failure to reattach the abductor. And what actually the surgeon did was they put in a constrained liner, and as you can see, these are not foolproof. They can fail as well. So the real problem must be identified and addressed in these situations. So you must see whether it's acetabular malposition, femoral malposition, abductor insufficiency, whether it's because of impingement, whether it's because of late onset polyethylene wear-induced instability, or a multifactorial causation. Each factor must be identified and addressed independently. So this is a 64-year-old schizophrenic who underwent a THR for fracture neck femur and dislocated following a fall. The key step for any dual mobility which dislocates or a constrained liner which dislocates is you don't try a closed reduction. Usually they require open reduction. So for any first dislocation, the management is by closed reduction. 75% of them will not dislocate again. However, dual mobility and constrained cups will require open reduction. So this is an important take-home message. To summarize, the patient with a primary THR, the first dislocation is done with closed reduction unless it's a dual mobility or a constrained liner. you brace the patient. So we typically use a knee brace to avoid flexion of the hip for 4 to 6 weeks. If it is successful, then you're lucky. It's unsuccessful, we must rule out infection, find the cause. If it's a component malposition, you do a liner exchange or a component revision, whatever may be the component. If there is soft tissue laxity and impingement, you increase the neck length, use a lateralized liner or a larger head size. Nowadays, we use a dual mobility socket. If there is abductor insufficiency, a positional or unknown etiology recurrent dislocation, we have to look at constrained liner or a dual mobility cup. In some situations, a bipolar and girdle stone becomes inevitable. So this in brief is the management strategy for identification of cause, identification of high risk factors, identification of the cause, and the management algorithm for instability after primary total hip replacement. Thank you.
Thank you, Krishna, for one more high quality lecture from your side. I mean, your experience says that you can manage all these problems with significant ease. It looks very easy from your hands. I know it's one of the most difficult problems to manage. Few questions. What is the difference between a constrained liner and a posterior leg augmentation device?
Yeah, so as I showed you in the video, the constrained liner is something which has got a constraining mechanism. Like you have a ring or something where the head gets locked into the polyethylene, and the ring now holds the head down into the polyethylene. So it all moves as a single construct. While augmentation is where, if you have an extended lip or something, you're just increasing the that directional stability by putting a lip. Problem with increasing the lip too much is that it will cause instability in the opposite direction. So if it increases stability in one direction by 20 degrees, the opposite direction stability is reduced by 20 degrees. So that is an issue with an elevated lip liner. So normally we use a 10 degree liner most often, but there are companies which give you 20 degrees of lip as well, like Smith & Nephew gives us 20 degrees lip. So I'm not personally comfortable using a lip liner at all, because if you use a 28 mm head, there is a significant risk of opposite directional instability. So we don't just reserve it for cases where there is an issue or you want to trial and then make a call based on that. So if you have a good stability, we don't use a lip liner at all. But if there is a borderline situation where you put everything in and you want a 10 degrees extra stability in one direction, probably it's an option. Constrained liner is completely different. You just use it in situations, elderly patients who've already got a well-fixed cemented socket, uncemented sockets, which you don't want to revise because it's messy, right? You want to remove everything, lot of bone loss, and again, stability issues and all. So you just cement a constrained liner into it. So that is the indication for a constrained liner, where the head gets locked into the polyethylene, either through a ring or through a snap fit mechanism or whatever, depends on the individual company.
And are there difficulties in removal of those constrained liners? Because it's just it's kind of a locking mechanism, isn't it? So like you said, if it's an uncemented cup, even the cup may pull off.
Correct. So uncemented cup, which is now already ingrown, it will not pull out because the cup has already ingrown. So that is one indication of a constrained liner. But you want to put it all afresh. Then if you look at literature as well, I don't see any reason of using a constrained liner in preference to a dual mobility socket. So you must use a dual mobility socket and do some sort of an abductor repair. So there are some people who argue that abductor insufficiency probably is an indication for constrained liner. So I would disagree, because the literature suggests that even in these situations, the failure rate for a constrained liner is as high as 40%, but dual mobility failure is in the range of 5 to 8%. So we would largely use a dual mobility. Only indication for a constrained in my book, already ingrown socket, you want to do a quick procedure in an elderly patient with limited life expectancy, you go in, put in a cemented constrained liner into the well ingrown socket, you just roughen the inner side, put in a cemented liner, get out fast in that particular patient.
So you wouldn't mind putting a dual mobility in a slightly younger patient, is it?
I would not put it if the patient has no risk factor for instability. But if there is a risk factor, I will not hesitate to put a dual mobility socket. So the challenge with dual mobilities is, if you look at the literature again, there is an 8% to 10% risk of intraprosthetic dislocation, which means there is polyethylene wear between the head and the large polyethylene head and the smaller head inside, and the containing mechanism gets damaged. So the head will disengage from the polyethylene and the polyethylene goes up and dislocates. So it's called intraprosthetic dislocation. The second issue is because of volumetric wear. You have a large polyethylene surface which is articulating with a metallic cup. So in a young patient, you will have the issue of polyethylene wear over the longer period of time. So these are the two problems with MDM. So we don't use it for routine total hip replacement at all. But in a patient with a fracture neck femur, in a patient with high risk for instability, we would not mind using it because their instability takes precedence over this complication which happens at 8 or 10 years. And secondly, we now have the highly cross-linked polyethylene with ceramic head options available from certain companies. The third problem with the MDM cup, like the Stryker dual mobility, is that you have a modular metallic liner, so which again adds an interface. So you again have risk of metal ion release with these interfaces. So routine use, we would not recommend. But in high-risk patients, we must do something more.
And intraprosthetic hip dislocation was a problem with the earlier designs, isn't it? Do the current designs also have a risk of these?
The intraprosthetic dislocation happens between 8 and 10 years. I don't think the current designs have got 10 years. They are not 10 years out yet. So we have to wait and watch whether they... I'm sure they will have, because if you have an indiscriminate use of these implants, there will be higher incidence of complications. So they are specifically for a certain category of patients who are at higher risk for instability. We must not routinely use them in all patients. That is the first mistake a lot of people are doing. If you do that sort of a mistake, it will become the next metal on metal. In the next 5 years, we will have issues with these metal ions. There are already a couple of papers on increased metal ions because of the modular dual mobility sockets, where there is a metal ring which gets locked into the acetabulum. So there is a risk of mal-seating it, and then you can have movement there and then more metal ion release.
And also the wear is going to be slightly higher, isn't it, if you put it for a younger patient, because there are two levels of articulation.
Absolutely. So we would not use it in a younger patient. I would not use it. If somebody is young and they don't have any risk factors for instability, we would not use a dual mobility. So in my hands, I would use it only in situations of neuromuscular issues or a paralytic situation, or somebody with a fracture neck femur in an elderly patient, or a complex revision where I'm using a cage for some reason, then I will use a dual mobility liner or a tumor resection.
Thank you, Krishna, for that.
Don't expect the life of the implant to be more than 10, 15 years, you know. So.
Yeah. Krishan, the other question is regarding the technique that you mentioned, that the Leo Whiteside's technique of advancement of the abductors in case there's significant soft tissue laxity. Now, can we really detect that pre-op, like before we go in for the revision? Is there a way that you're looking at soft by your clinical examination or something like that?
This technique is for abductor insufficiency. It's not for lax abductors. So you know pre-op, somebody's got an abductor weakness, you examine him, there's no hip abduction, it's a paralytic situation. But the hip extensor is all right, the gluteus maximus is all right. So what we actually do is we don't advance the abductor. We take the anterior half of the gluteus maximus, which contains the tensor fascia part. And then we take a flap of that and then stitch it onto the bone and onto the vastus lateralis and onto the abductor insertion. So you make drill holes in the greater trochanter and stitch that part onto the, redirect that muscle onto the abductor line of tension. And then you close the remaining part of the gluteus over the top of this particular thing. So it will add 2 points. If a best case scenario, it will work like some abductor, the anterior half of the muscle. That is the ideal situation. But what it actually does is it increases the tension in the soft tissues there. So it will avoid just a lax hip-related dislocation for that particular patient. So we have done it in 10 to 12 situations, and the outcomes are pretty good in our limited experience.
I think that will be more of an intra-op decision, isn't it, or a pre-op?
All patients with abductor insufficiency, we do it now. So we don't wait for... For instability, you have to do everything at the first go. You should not wait for next time we will do something, because it's a disaster for the patient. And believe me, it will keep on happening. So if we don't address everything, you should go aggressive, right? You should go put in a dual mobility socket, get your component position version right, use the correct femoral component, restore the soft tissue tension, restore the abductor strength, everything in one go. So everything is given. So you don't now put a 28 to 32 head. Next time, if it dislocates, I will put a dual mobility. That is not the concept now. We will do everything possible to avoid a further dislocation.
Okay, Krishan. I think that's all the questions that we have. It was a fantastic session. Instability is such a difficult topic. Even I've seen experienced surgeons having problems with their dislocations. So I think this is one of the very, very important topics in hip arthroplasty. Thank you, Krishna, for addressing it wonderfully with really good examples.
Thank you.
And we really look forward for another lecture. All of your lectures have been really, really engaging and was very, very informative. Thank you once again.
Thanks, Hitesh. Thanks for having me.